welcome to sharing God's Word together. And our scripture today our main scripture is John 1, 1 to 18. It's found on page 750 of your pew Bible if you want to follow along, or you can follow along on the slide. Now this series, it's one that was put together by Chip Ingram of the Venture Community Church in San Francisco area in California, and it's been used by churches across the country. It's a good way to kind of get into what is God's real nature, what does God want us to know and celebrate about Him so that we can follow Him more faithfully. And so we're going to be doing an 8-week study and worship and Bible study and Sunday school and other places together to celebrate God's true character. And the first scripture here, and this you're going to get a lot of scripture today. This is kind of a Bible overview approach to the life of discipleship. I tend to pick one passage and dig into it deeply. This is a series that gives you a broader biblical sweep of things. Anyway, listen now to God's Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made. In Him was life, and the life was the light of men. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man who sent from God, whose name was John. He came as a witness to bear witness about the light, that all might believe through him. He was not the light, but came to bear witness about the light. The true light, which gives light to everyone, was coming into the world. He was in the world, and the world was made through him, yet the world did not know him. He came to his own, and his own people did not receive him. But to all who did receive him, who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God, who were born not of blood, or the will of the flesh, or the will of man, but of God. And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth. We have seen his glory. Glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth. John bore witness about him and cried out, "This was he of whom I said, 'He who comes after me ranks before me, because he was before me.' For from his fullness we have received grace upon grace. For the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God. God the only Son, who is at the Father's side, he has made him known." May God add his blessings to his holy word. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, open our hearts and minds to know and hear your word, that we might be faithful followers and obedient disciples. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, I skipped the earlier video that's just kind of an introduction, just to save time this morning. So I'm going to try the one that introduces this. This is kind of a 4-minute little vignette to introduce how people look at God. If this doesn't work in PowerPoint, y'all could bring the sound up in the booth, please.
Hey, what you listening to?
Okay, this is running choppy, so I'm going to back out of the PowerPoint real quick and go directly to the video. And it won't format quite as well, but it'll run smoother. Called the vending machine.
Be good, Landon.
Hey, what you listening to?
When you think about God, who do you imagine he is? Do you see him as someone who likes to give you good things? And what do you think that really means, anyway? Does it mean he's kind of like...
a vending machine?
I was going to say a magic genie, but sure, vending machine works. Let's go with that.
That's weird.
No, I don't think it's that weird. And the elevator's broken anyway, so you might as well go along with it.
Hey, what's in there?
There you go. That's the spirit. Anyway, as I was saying, if we see God like a vending machine, we might think he's just there to grant our wishes, to give us the stuff that's most important to us.
It's...
with a never-ending supply of
whatever we want.
Sounds pretty cool, right? Maybe you're like Diana. And you want to be the MVP of the softball team. Punch in D6.
I won!
Yeah!
I'm an MVP! That's what I'm talking about! What?
Or... maybe you want to be really popular. That's C3.
Yeah!
Or maybe you want that report card with all A's on it. Punch in B5. But... maybe God is a vending machine? This is such a good idea. Sure, it's great to punch in whatever you want, but...
hey!
What if God has a purpose for you that's greater than just getting what you want? Maybe God knows that what we want isn't always what we need. The Bible says God is so good and loves us so much, not to just always give us everything we ask for. Sometimes the things we pick fall apart in our hands. God cares more about giving us what we need instead of what we want.
Really? Come on!
Did you know that what you think about God is the most important thing about you? So how should you think about God? Maybe it's better if you let God tell you who he is. And base your picture of him on what he says about himself. The real God loves to give you good things, but he's only going to give you what's best for you.
Okay, seeking God is our theme for today. Finding the real God, we got to seek him out. And there's a little insert in your bulletin. We've got lots of inserts today. One's kind of a study guide for you to take home, and it's got a little, some little graphs that you can chart your own progress on and things like that. So if you want to pull that out while we go through this, that would be a good thing. But it begins with a couple of quotes here from a classic book on Christian devotions by A.W. Tozer, The Knowledge of the Holy. He says two things. What comes into our minds when we think about God is the most important thing about us, that mental image we have of God. He also says that we can, by a secret law of the soul, to move towards our mental image of God. And usually the mental images we come up with are not always the most accurate. Let's brainstorm for a second. What are some of the images that people have of their Creator? And I'm not thinking church well-trained people, but just the general public out there. How do they imagine God? We just saw a vending machine. Some people think you punt the money in and he dispenses gifts back. What other images are out there?
Santa Claus.
Santa Claus. Okay, that's another thing similar to the vending machine.
The genie.
The genie. Okay, rub the lamp and make a wish. He'll grant you whatever you want. That's good.
Old man on the throne.
Old man on the throne, upstairs. The kindly grandfather figure who's just kind of doting on things and helping things along when he has a little energy. What else?
Judgmental and harsh.
Okay. The sheriff. The law enforcer who's going to come down on every little infraction that you may mess up in your life. Okay, that's an image a lot of people have. Any others? There's the butler. There's the grandma figure, not just the old man upstairs, but the nice granny who feeds us biscuits and goodies all the time and makes sure that we're happy and content. See, but these are the kind of images that people have. And we've got to come up with a better understanding of what God is like. He's either kind of the harsh enforcer on one end or the kindly grandmother or genie on the other end who dispenses goodies for us to keep us happy. But we've got to remember that God is so bigger than anything we can imagine, bigger and greater and holy, which means he's beyond any human imagination or understanding. And we've got to come to grips with that. But he's also loving and involved in our world. Theologians use two different words to describe this. One is the transcendence of God, the power and authority and awesomeness of God. The other word is immanence, his presence in our world and love and grace and mercy that he shows behind to each of us. So we've got to balance both of these parameters here to get an accurate view of what God is like. And we don't get this by making it up on our own. We've got to go to what God says about us. And this is where we are with this invitation of a lifetime here in your little study guide, is to consider what God is really like. And this message, actually, they give me a 24-page manuscript here to preach to you here today, but I'm not going to give you all 24 pages of that. I'm just going to pull out the highlights here because there's plenty here for us to work on, just even in the highlights along the way here. So, but the point is to get off started here is we're all a little off on our view of God. But the most important journey that we can have is finding an accurate perception of what God is like. Not the God that I want or would come up with, or the God that you would want or come up with. Because our God tends to be too small when we do it by our standards. He's either too harsh one way, too free and easy on the other, or some other corruption that we come up with. But to see God as God really is, we need 20/20 vision and avoid three mistakes that people make when they start thinking about God. And the first one is this. God is not like you. We've got to get this into our minds. Important parameter here if we're going to have a proper vision of God. God is not like a bigger version of you or me or somebody else along the way. The only person that gets to make that claim is Jesus. God is like Jesus and Jesus is like God. So, but God is not like us. Our tendency is to take the best that we can think of, the kindest person, the best person, the most holy person then somehow blow it up by 10, 100, or 1,000 times, and God is like that, only bigger and better. But God is more than anything created, even more than the angels. God is bigger and more powerful and more holy. He's a cut above. He's not like us, but something that only he himself can reveal to us. The prophet Isaiah uses these words to describe what is God, what God is like. To whom then will you liken me, that I should be his equal, or that you can compare me, says the Holy One? Lift up your eyes and look to the heavens. Who created all these things that are before you? He who brings out the starry hosts one by one and calls forth each of them by name. Because of his great power and mighty strength, not one of them is missing. Why do you complain, O Jacob? And why do you say, Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, my cause is disregarded by my God? Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired or weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. God is completely different. That's a good thing to know. That's why in the Ten Commandments he says that there are no other gods, no images, no pictures, nothing that can reduce him and put him in a box. Nothing that we can do to belittle him. Now, God is not safe either. If you've ever read the book, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe, and the Chronicles of Narnia, there's a question that comes up with them as the children, the Pevensey children, go into Narnia and meet Aslan, the lion, who represents Jesus in that realm. They ask, is he safe? The beavers, their friends there, answer to them and said, no, Aslan is loving, he's kind, but he's certainly not safe or tame. God, Jesus are bigger than that. And that's why Romans 11, Paul picks up on this kind of thing as well. He says, the depth of riches, both of the wisdom and knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgment and unfathomable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who can become his counselor? The answer there is no one. Or who has given to him that it might be paid back along the way? No one can do or give anything that is paid back to the Lord. But we do have this closing thought. For from him and through him, all things come from God. To him belong the glory and glory forever. So everything is rooted in God, it comes from God, and it returns back to God. And that's what the life of devotion is all about. Knowing that we are from God, and that we go back to God, and that we belong to him. And this is why it's important to know that we are not like God. We are God's creations, God's handiwork along the way. And that's what we try to know and celebrate together. Now the second item that we need to remember, our rule here that helps us to clue in on God is that we tend to reduce God to manageable terms, as we've implied here in the first point. I want a God that I can see. I want a God that I can control. I want a God that I can tame and manipulate. But that's not the God of the Bible. The ancient religions tried to put God in a box and make God manageable by shaping idols and statues to represent their gods. And even the Israelites did this at one point in time. Remember, as they were delivered from bondage in Israel and were there before Mount Sinai, and Moses went up on the mountain to get the main commandments from God, what did the Israelites do while left down in the valley below while Moses was delayed on the mountain talking with the Lord? Well, they collected all the jewelry, gave it to Aaron, and he threw it in the fire, and what did Aaron say happened? Well, suddenly this golden calf just appeared coming out of the fire, and we had to worship it. Is that how it happens? No. That's the foolishness of these people who saw the mighty hand of God deliver them from Pharaoh's hand and all the plagues, and they got through the Red Sea. You can sing Pharaoh for them if you want. tell them the story of Pharaoh and Moses and the people going to the Red Sea and stuff. But still, even after all that, they wanted to reduce God to a manageable form, make him in the image of a worship statues quite like the ancients did, but we worship other things, fame, wealth, money, power, glory, all these things that the world puts before us as things that should be served and put before the Lord. Does anybody get eternal life or glory out of fame, power, wealth, beauty, any of those things? Jesus said, what does it profit a man or a woman to gain the whole world but then forfeit their soul or eternal life? No, we are spiritual beings and we need to prepare for our spiritual destiny in the time that we are here in this world. And there are two big idols that we particularly want to do today, and two corruptions of the Christian faith. The first is the idol of happiness and self-fulfillment. It's kind of turning God into the genie, as we mentioned, or the Santa Claus, or the vending machine. That God is here to make us happy. God wants us to be happy, but that's not the end and all being and purpose of our life. Sometimes we have to participate in the sufferings of the Lord and sacrifice for his kingdom in order to become true and faithful disciples here. And so, there are a lot of preachers today that are preaching self-help and happiness and fulfillment. And it's come to Jesus and all your problems will go away. You'll have wealth and money and prosperity. You won't get cancer. You won't get sick. You'll probably live to be 95 and then just suddenly die peaceably in your bed. Can any preacher guarantee that?
No.
I certainly can't guarantee that. We all go through life struggling together. We lose friends and loved ones here fighting cancer. And these are faithful, godly people that are afflicted in this way. So we can't go in that direction. But that's one of the things that we want to do, is think that God's here to wait on us. Now, the other idol is the Sabbath bar approach to Christianity. God gave 10 great commandments, 10 main commandments. There's about 589, I believe, in the Old Testament, the 10 main ones. Wouldn't it be easy if you could pick which 7 or 8 you wanted to follow and leave the other 2 or 3 out? How much of modern spirituality is like that? That's why we left one denomination, because they were beginning to water down the commandments of God and join another. And so I always salute this congregation, that they are standing for the whole counsel of God's word and not trying to pick and choose just what we want to do and then focus on that and then deride anybody who wants to keep the other commandments. See, when we start picking the commandments which are okay to follow and eliminate others, who's actually setting themselves up as God at that point?
We are.
We become our own little gods here, trying to reduce God to manageable terms. We can't do that. So we've got to move beyond this. We can't do it in our own manageable little box. We've got to move beyond this to the next things that God gives us. And this is where we really clue in on God's nature and character. We can only know God as he reveals himself to us. When we try and figure it out on our own, what theologians call natural religion, you sit down and come up with an idea of what God might be like, that being beyond which is greater than anyone can conceive, we'll come up with our own little boxes and idols and things like this. But when God shows us what he is like, when we meet the real God in his real character and real being, then we clue in and can have a fruitful spiritual life. And so this is what we get together here. And there are several different ways that God reveals himself to us that the scriptures tell us. The first one is through nature. Not everybody gets God through nature, but for those of us who do, for me, sitting on a mountainside, looking down at the valley below, and seeing the expanse of the skies above, I say, hey, there has to be a creator behind this. I know it, I sense it, I feel it. Now, some of y'all aren't mountain people. Some of y'all are beach people. What happens when you go and sit on the beach in the sand? Wow, there must be a creator making these waters and the waves and everything go like that. Then there are other ways. Some people do it with flowers. Some people do it with animals, things like that. But the heavens declare the glory of God, Psalm 19 tells us. The skies proclaim the work of his hands day after day. They pour forth speech night after night. They reveal knowledge. Nature, the created order, bears witness to the fact that there is a creator. And so That's what we celebrate here. That's our first cue of what God is like, that God is the all-powerful creator that holds the stars in his hands and the galaxies and everything else. And we get to be a part of that, but we aren't in control of that. Now, the next thing place God reveals his nature to us is his work. We've got the created world order, and then we have the accumulated knowledge of God's people put together here. Now, people go through this life saying, I sure wish God would speak to us and tell us what he is like and what he wants in our lives. What are they missing out? All they got to do is open the book and begin to study it. We spent last weekend getting a handle on that for teenagers, how to begin to unpack Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John in particular is the place to start the life of Jesus and go through there. Hebrews 4 tells us, the word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of the soul and spirit, of joints and of marrow, discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. We read God's word, it's a window into the heavenly realm. It's also God's voice coming back to us. Sometimes it pierces us and says, oh boy, I'm very much off track in what I'm doing in my life today. I need to get back in harmony with the Lord. Other times it lifts us up and gives us strength, but there's all sorts of writings here to get us through different times and situations. Going back to John 1, that we started the service, our message with, the word is also present as Jesus coming into the world. In the beginning was the word was with God, and the word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made, or without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and the life was the light of all mankind. So we celebrate this together. We have the written word, we have the living word, Jesus, and together they work to lead us and guide us, and by the power of his spirit we are challenged and convicted to move forward. And the third and final blessing that we get is directly through Jesus, his son. Jesus is God's personal nature come down here on earth. Lots of passages here. Again, John 1 picks up, the word became flesh, made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the only one from the Father, only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth. John testified him and cried out, this is the one of whom I spoke about when I said, he who comes after me has surpassed me because he was before me. And of his fullness we have all received grace in place of grace already given. The law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. No one has ever seen God, but the one and only Son, who is himself God and is in closest relationship with the Father, he has made God known. So we come to Jesus, that Jesus is God's presence in human time and space and history and flesh and blood, so that we can know the nature of God brought down to our level. And this is his blessings and his truth. In the little study guide you got there, you can read some other scriptures that go along with this here. But it concludes with what this leads us to is a passionate relationship and knowledge and experience of God that you have there at the very end. You have a little set of graphs there on the handout that you can take home and check and see how you are. Where is your energy for God? How great are your thoughts for God? How great is your boldness for God? And do you have a great commitment in and for God? This is the ultimate end result of the spiritual life and what we all try to know and share together. And we measure this and work on this from week to week. So come and seek the Lord. He's the one who wants to be found. But better yet, realize that God is seeking you. God sent his Son into the world. The word became flesh and revealed God's nature so that you could know him and experience him. You don't want to know what God is like? Look to Jesus, the Savior. Is God loving and kind and forgiving? Is God powerful and over life and death in the grave? Yes, we see those things in Jesus. And so we come to him and know him and serve him with all the depths of our heart. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we seek you, but we are grateful to know that you first sought us and sent Jesus into the world to be the life and peace that we all need. Draw us into his presence and into a sure and certain knowledge of his love and living existence so that we might find that eternal life and joy that you would have all your people to enjoy. Thank you for your blessings, Lord. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now the youth are going to stand and help us with our closing hymn that celebrates all this and summarizes the life of Jesus about as well as any single song that I've ever learned. So we worked on this on the retreat. It's called I Danced in the Morning, also known as Lord of the Dance. And it was written that covers the full sweep of Jesus' life and the power and glory that he has. Let's stand and join together in this song. You can go across the front here. Then as we finish, they're going to scoot out at the very end so they can go get set up for lunch and we can all go and enjoy a good time with them. What's that? Words on the screen. Actually, I don't have the words for this on the screen. They're all in the bulletin. Here this morning, so that you can plug into this eternal spiritual life that Jesus gives and know his peace and joy and abundant life that he gives for all eternity. If you haven't seen it, I'd love to have you talk with you. Talk with you down here if you're interested in it for lunch. We invite everybody to stay for lunch and to enjoy some good spaghetti with us and to support the evening. I'm going to go ahead and do the blessing here so that you can just jump right in. And they're going down and getting set up for everything right now. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for your word and the fact that you seek us so that we can truly find you and you show us what your nature is like through the life and death and teachings and resurrection of your Son. Help us to follow him because he's the dance that we follow each and every day. And we live in him and he lives in us and we celebrate that life together. Bless the food and fellowship we're about to share together and use it to strengthen us and guide us always for your glory as we work together in your service. Thank you, Lord, for all that you give us. In Jesus' name, amen.